we have back with us to discuss vote buying, UCLA Assistant Professor Cesi Cruz. Good morning from Manila, Professor Cruz. Good afternoon in California. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me, Mike.
All right. First, Professor Cruz, let's give our viewers a bit of a background on that study of yours. How many households were involved and what was the purpose of that study?
So that study was to really understand the dynamics of vote buying. So here we were looking at 1,600 households, but we've also done follow-up surveys as well in Ilocos Norte and Ilocos Sur, pretty much every election, just to understand not just why politicians are buying votes, but what that means for the voters that are accepting them as well.
Mm-hmm. And when we talk about social networks, for the purpose of your study, what groups are we talking about?
Here we're talking about not just, well, you know, usually we'll think about things like church groups or organizations or, unions, but here we also mean things like your friends and family, the people in your barangay, your neighbors. And what I found in that work is that it's not just a matter of, even if our ballots are secret, usually people in our extended network will know how we voted, or they'll be able to guess how we voted. And so that makes those types of strategies of keeping, the idea of voting and voting your conscience once you're in the ballot box, that makes it a little bit harder to do those kind of strategies as a voter.
Mm-hmm. We'll get to that in a bit. But just to be clear, we're not yet talking about networks on social media, right? Which could be another factor altogether. So when you talk about social networks, this refers to our network in the community, not on social media. All right. Now, let's discuss the findings. Your study found that the larger the social network, the more likely it will be that network will be targeted for vote buying, and the more likely that vote buying will influence a person's vote. Why is this?
That's because from the politician's standpoint, targeting larger social networks is easier. It's logistically easier. It's easier to find, people in a group. It's easier to just show up outside the church. You wait outside the church after mass, and then you can buy the votes of the whole church. It's also easier for politicians to monitor how people vote. If people are in larger groups, then it's easier for that to map up to the types of election results that you might get by precincts, and then politicians can sort of have an idea of how maybe a whole neighborhood might vote, or maybe how a whole group might vote, even if they don't know how individual people vote. So for politicians, that's a lot easier in terms of just basic logistics, easier to reach people. But importantly for them, it's also easier to monitor to make sure that they're getting their money's worth when they're buying, when they're paying people for their votes.
Mm-hmm. And well, just to talk about that, if you're part of a larger group, wouldn't it be more difficult for the head of that group to actually account for the votes of each of the members of that particular group, as a counter argument to that statement?
That's a good point, but it actually, that often works the opposite way, where instead of having to negotiate with a whole lot of different people, that politicians can just go to the head of a family or the head of a church or the head of a group and try to get their help with delivering the votes. Now, I think you're right in that the larger that group gets, the harder it is to enforce mm-hmm. that type of agreement within the group. But if you think about it, for politicians, they don't need that compliance to be 100%, right? Like if they're getting 80 to 90% of voters voting according to what they expected, then that's usually enough for them. And for them, like the amount of, in terms of they're thinking about a cost benefit analysis, where they're thinking about how much money they're spending and buying in terms of votes, a return like that is usually a really good deal for politicians.
And your study also mentioned the element of fear of reprisal. How did it become a factor in your study, and what forms do these come from? Reprisals in terms of, is there actual violence involved, or is it also meant as a form of reprisal for the individual or for the group?
Both, actually, Mike. So I think that's one of the big concerns I have, and why I think it's not just a matter of telling voters, it's not a big deal, you just accept the money and then you can vote for whoever you want. Because that works in some places, but in Isabela, for example, in some places in other provinces, we've seen politicians Even sometimes jokingly, you know, they'll say, oh, hindi mo naman ako binoto, or you didn't vote for me. And those types of things where even if not said in a threatening manner, I think people can be very fearful of those types of interactions, especially since for most Filipinos, our mayor or our local politicians, those are the people we go to for help. And so the idea that if you're afraid that you cannot approach the mayor, right, if you didn't vote for the mayor, then that's a very big reprisal already. But we've also seen the opposite extremes as well in my work, where people have reported being intimidated or being denied services or denied access to government, government benefits and government processes, just as a result of how they voted. And for that, I think that's the really crucial piece that we sometimes don't see when we're studying this topic. You know, we'll see people getting money for their vote, and maybe they vote accordingly or not, but it's often very hard for us researchers to observe, you know, the consequences down the line and the ways that these things can be dangerous as well.
But just to be clear, based on your respondents, how many of them actually accepted the money and voted according to that? I mean, voted in favor of the one who actually gave them the money?
The vast majority of people, when they accept money, they do vote for the person. And what they tell me is that it's not, sometimes it's not even because they're afraid of the politicians, but it's utang na loob, you know, we feel obligated. We feel like that's the expectation. And so for me, you know, as a researcher, if politicians were just giving money, you know, to sort of support, you know, pamasahe or to support people going to vote, and then the people were going to vote for the politician anyway, then I think, you know, that's much better. But when it comes with all these extra obligations, and when it comes with fear and coercion, I think that's when it's really tricky.
Mm-hmm. Now, a fundamental question to all of these is why a person would be compelled to vote with the rest of a group when in theory, no one should know whom you voted for. So, but you mentioned earlier, politicians know if the persons they gave money to voted for them. But is this really a question of ballot secrecy or just the perception of whether the ballot you cast is secret or not?
You got it exactly right there, where for politicians, it's actually the perception that's more important to them. I remember one of the mayors we were talking to and I told him, you know, Mr. Mayor, you can't actually know how all these people voted. And he said, it's not important if I know how they voted or not. What's important is they think that I know, right? And this idea that as long as people think that he can figure it out, that they're going to follow through on voting for him after they accept the money. And the reason for that perception is that politicians can often guess, right? Like if we get results by precinct and barangays are small enough, you can usually pretty reasonably guess how people might vote. And just being able to do that, I think, is what scares people, and scares, especially when you're part of a big group, like a big community or a big church, where those types of identifying factors make it even easier for politicians to maybe guess how you voted.
Mm-hmm. And well, let's go to a key finding in your study. Politicians using social networks for vote buying in cases where the vote is perceived to be secret, but there is a negative relationship between vote buying and social ties when the vote is not secret. So can you elaborate on this? Explain to us how this worked based on your study.
So that part of the study. So there's two reasons for that part. One is as a way of trying to rule out other explanations, right? So we wanted to see how does vote buying matter, or how is monitoring an important part of vote buying? Because that's something that actually for researchers we don't understand very well. Mm-hmm. But the second part of that is also highlights the importance of these processes in a ways that sometimes we think it's no big deal. You know, being able to, for example, in a precinct, if you're voting and then you feel like you have privacy, versus sometimes, you know, I remember going with my aunties to vote and then there's so many people, everybody's sitting next to each other. So there, that just the fact that I perceive that people were around and able to see how I voted can make me feel less confident about democracy, less confident about my vote and whether the elections were fair, even if there's no, you know, even if there's no actual violation of my ballot secrecy. So this idea that perceptions are really important and they matter for how politicians relate with voters, but also how voters perceive the democracy and the fairness of the process. I think those are the sort of key takeaways, that even very small improvements in how we do our voting process, even things like your waiting time to vote, you know, whether machines broke down or not, those things seem like small things, but they actually contribute a lot to people feeling good and people feeling like elections are fair. And so for me, one really small way of improving our elections is just, you know, get all of those things right in terms of the process, make everything as fair as possible, and make it easy for people to vote. And then all of those other things will, you know, in terms of good attitudes and perceptions, will follow as a result.
So now, given this perception, Professor Cruz, what are the implications of your study's findings and Vice President Danny Robredo's statement the other day that while vote buying is wrong, if a voter is offered money by a politician, accept it, but vote according to your conscience? To be fair, she's not the only one who said this, but will this work based on the findings of your study?
Yes and no. So I think it works for the individual voter. It actually, I think, I don't know how others feel about this, but my feeling is it's super awkward and to just have to say no, to decline money if somebody's offering you money in for vote, or somebody's offering you a campaign t-shirt, right? Even it's almost better to just take it and then not wear it, but it's almost impolite, I think, for us as Filipinos. And so I do, when I do advise people, I also say the same thing, you know, take the money and then vote your conscience, to at least mitigate the bad parts and the bad choices that might come out of that. Now, I say this, but with that big caveat that that's only in cases where you don't have to worry about things like coercion or violence after the election, because we have to understand that not everybody can implement that kind of strategy safely, right? Like if you're afraid that, let's say all of you in a barangay, you all decide to vote your conscience, but if the politician knew that he bought the votes of everybody there, after the elections, you know, he can come back and maybe and retaliate, or you know, we've seen that happen where, you know, politicians will do things like remove water pumps, or, you know, come send their you know, private armies around to intimidate voters. And so at an individual level, it's a strategy that works well, but at the group level, you know, the bigger these groups get, then it's hard to do a strategy like that. And it's much better for us to try to think of more broader and more holistic ways of reducing vote buying.
And on a practical matter, how do we deal with vote buying? How should we deal with vote buying?
So I love this question, because I actually have, I think what we have is some of our newer work has some answers on that. And that's actually letting people make their choices when it comes to vote buying, when it comes to assessing candidates. What we found, for example, is that if you give voters the information, like if you tell voters, you know, this is how much money goes to your municipality, this is how much money that you're being offered for your vote, I think people sometimes will surprise us and make much more sophisticated choices. So, for example, in some of our work in Ilocos Norte and Sur, we found that voters, when you give them information about candidates, they're much more likely to vote for the candidates whose policy preferences matches theirs. And to me, that was something really exciting, because we had never seen that in the Philippines before, at least, you know, in my, you know, doing that kind of research. But if you think about it, it's quite simple. When, you know, voters were telling us, wait a minute, if the municipality gets this many million pesos, and then the vote buying we're getting is only this much, then I'd rather have, you know, the municipal funds for schools and roads and other things instead of this one-time payment during the election. And that's actually something that we see with politicians as well. The idea that you just need something to sort of break that pattern of and those expectations. Because one mayor told me, he said, look, Cesi, it's cheaper for me to build schools and fix roads. If I could win the election by building schools and fixing roads, then I would do it. And so for me, that's really telling, and that in a way, vote buying is actually not the most efficient way for politicians to campaign, just that they're sort of stuck in the cycle of having done it for so long that that's what's expected. So a lot of the work that we're doing now with COMELEC and with other groups is, you know, finding ways for voters to become more informed. Right, mm-hmm. To make themselves more intelligent voters and informed voters, so that they can move towards being able to demand the kinds of things that they want from their politician beyond just, you know, a one-time payment on election day.
All right. So we look forward to more research from you, Assistant Professor Cesi Cruz from the UCLA. Thank you for joining us this morning.
Thank you.